Section 5.2, Archive Shift. Now here's a graphic depiction of the shifting algorithm. Basically it works something like this. When this archive, the initial primary archive, which is at position 0, when that archive fills entirely, or I should say fills to 99.8% fill, or if it only has 30 minutes of space left in it, then at that point we will do a shift. As I mentioned, that's user configurable. I'll mention that later on, how you can change that fill trigger. But anyway, when that is just about full, we will initiate a shift. What we're going to do is we're going to look for the highest shiftable archive. Now the highest shiftable archive is either going to be an empty archive, or it's going to be the oldest archive, if there are no empty archives. So basically, you can quote this: if it exists, an empty archive will be selected to be the new primary. If no empty archive exists, then the oldest archive will become the primary and its existing data will be overwritten. So in this event here, we have a position 0, which was the primary archive. We have filled this entirely. So as of the time of the next shift, we're going to take this highest empty archive and we're going to make that the new primary archive. So after the first shift, this is what you see. This used to be over here as the highest empty archive. Now it becomes the primary archive. And what was PyArk 001 was the primary archive. That's now the archive in position 1. So position 1 is always the second most recent archive. Position 0 is the primary. This is the one most recent next to the primary. Now, as I said, this only happens when the primary archive is just about full. And the rule is, as I said, we use the highest number empty archive if an empty archive exists, or if they're all full, the oldest archive is used. Now, alternately, you actually can do a force shift. If you look at the PI System Management Tools, within the Operations section, within Archives, you can select PyArk 001. And now here's something you shouldn't do at home. You can right-click on that and choose Force Shift. You can also see a button up here that does the same thing, Forced Shift. So let me demonstrate. I'm currently looking at archives. This is Archives 0, 1, and 2. And if we move this back, I'll go ahead and force a shift. Again, you should never do this at home unless you're working with tech support on some kind of a problem. I'll go ahead and force the archive to shift. I'll then resequence this. Once this shift is finished, I'll resequence this in order 012. And once we do that, we should see that the highest empty archive, which is currently PyArk 003, the highest empty archive is now going to be the primary archive. So let me go ahead and resequence this. 012. What you see now, there we go, PyArk 003, which used to be the highest empty archive, it's now the primary archive. Okay, the start time is just a second ago, and the current time is the end time. And here is the archive that was previous to that, the primary archive. It's now Archive 1 in the order. Let's take a look at how that shift algorithm would work if we had, for example, instead of just the 3 archives, we started out with a grand total of 10 archives initially. With 10 archives initially, let's say we started that exactly on the 1st of January of the year, then of course PyArk 001, that's actually the first created and the first registered during the install, that would be the primary archive. And then these other archives, 2 through 10, they would actually be empty at that point, and 10 would be the most recently registered. It would also be the last or the highest empty archive. The numbering of the archives is determined by the order in which they were registered. So since this is the most recent one, PyArk 00 or 010 is the most recent one registered, it's going to be the highest empty archive. So when this archive fills entirely, at that point we need to write to a new archive. So again, we go to the highest empty archive. That ends up being Archive 10. Now to see how in this case it really, you know, these numbers here, they really don't mean anything. Very soon after you start working with the system, you'll notice these numberings are not going to take any kind of a sequence that's meaningful. So we suggest you avoid, inferring from the sequence that that has something to do with the time order. So when this archive is full entirely, at that point we're going to shift. Now the highest empty archive is the one before archive 10, which is archive 9. So we keep on doing that. Now there is one restriction, or a few restrictions, when we do this shifting. First of all, the archive has to be registered. So it has to be an empty archive that's been registered. It has to be shiftable. You can actually make an archive non-shiftable. That's something you can do over in the graphical user interface. Again, if I go here, I can make this non-shiftable if I prefer not to let this shift on top. Okay. And it has to be writable. Again, you can make something non-writable. And it also has to be large enough to handle the current size of the point database. Now remember, I said that 50% no more than 50% of the size of an archive can be devoted to primary records. And you need a primary record for every single tag in the Pi system. So if I use my example from before, if these are 100 megabyte archives, this should not be a problem for any of these to be shifted into, because I've only got a 10,000 point system. 100 megabyte archive gives me 100,000 1K records, so I can actually go all the way up to 50,000 points. Now, a very minor digression here, not terribly important, but this is the reason, the fact that the Pi system cannot shift into an archive that is not big enough to account for the point database, that's a good reason why we always shift to the highest empty archive. See, let's just suppose that your system has grown, and instead of 10,000 tags, now it's 40,000 tags. And then maybe next time you shift, it'll be 55,000 tags. Well, if you remember, if it's 55,000 tags, these 100 megabyte archives aren't going to be big enough. So if you, in anticipation of this, created 3 or 4 new archives and made them all 200 megabytes in size, well, those are now going to be the highest empty archives. So it makes logical sense to shift into those. Those are the ones that you've touched the most recently. So they're probably going to be the ones that can accommodate the current point database count. Now, extending our timeline here through the shifting into these archives, and then this archive, and then this archive, at this point right here, what is this, about mid-April, at this point in the timeline, we are now faced with a situation in which this archive is completely full. We cannot store any more data into that. And all the other archives, as you see, have already been shifted into. They all contain data. Well, at this point, if there are no more shiftable and empty archives, then at this point, what we do is we go to the oldest archive in the system that is shiftable. And that's, in this case, it's going to go back to PyArch 001. It's going to overwrite that immediately. It's going to, when this shift, it's going to zero this out and start writing to this over again. So what does that mean? Well, it means that this data right here, it's no longer going to be available. That's just basically been thrown away. It's been overwritten. And when we shift into this, we're going to throw away this data. When we shift into this, we're going to throw away this data. Now, it seems rather extreme, but in fact, the system was designed so that you could let it go for years and years without touching it, and we would simply continue to overwrite data and move forward in time. Now, presumably, you're going to have backups, or we recommend you have backups before this overwriting occurs. So the system was designed to use a finite number of archives and just simply continue to overwrite them, and if you neglect the system, as we have seen customers do sometimes. They neglect the system for years on end. You know, maybe somebody left a job and it's a while for somebody else to come in and become the manager. We don't want the system to break down because it runs out of disk space. And a system set up like this will not run out of disk space. It will just simply continue to overwrite those archives. And of course, the danger of this, we certainly want to make sure that at the time this happens, where we shift on top of an existing archive, we've already got a good backup of that archive. So if you don't want anything bad to happen, there's a couple of choices for you. First of all, just keep adding empty archives. You add them once a month or so. As long as you keep adding empty archives, then we'll never overwrite archives like we've done here in this example. And the other thing to do is to just let the system add archives for you. We have an auto-archiving system that's available starting with version Pi version 3.4 and later, and just make sure you've got plenty of disk space, because see, now that nice little design goal in which you can ignore the system for years and it continues to run. Well, if you're auto creating archives, that really doesn't happen anymore. Now you do have to make sure you've got enough free disk space. Of course, nowadays that's usually not much of an issue. Okay. Now, one last thing I should mention about these archives is if you do want an archive to persist for a long time, like for example, this right here, this archive represents the time when, oh, I don't know, the chlorine gas went wafting over the local high school, and everybody's still trying to figure out who to sue and who to blame and whatnot. So this is obviously something people are going to look at for a long, long time. You don't want that to be shifted onto. No problem. Just make it non-shiftable. Okay? Then that will stay on that system. It will basically will just skip right over when it's time to shift again. We'll skip right over and shift to the next one. Now, we also suggest that you make non-shiftable anything that's on removable media. There are folks that like to mount or register archives that are on CD drives, network drives, things like that. So if you've got some kind of a archive set up like that, good idea to make those non-shiftable.